Linda, with a commodity surge and a possible super cycle looming, how does this affect how you do business? Tell us about input costs. Tell us about shipping costs. Are you raising your prices?
Yeah, I mean, for us, certainly in the auto business, raising prices is never an option. We have to give price reductions to our customers every year, and price increases are not generally entertained. So that just means we need to work really hard to try to manage the commodity cost increases. Some costs are allowed for in terms of our contract. So for instance, metal, the cost of metal, particularly aluminum, which is a very high cost metal, we do have metal market pass-through adjustments in our contracts based on predetermined metal market indices. So, you know, we will agree with a customer and our supplier on a set market index, and then prices will adjust every quarter around that. So, you know, we're covered off on things like aluminum. On steel prices, not 100% covered off. I would say maybe 2/3 of our contracts have a similar kind of mechanism in our contract. So, and then when it comes to other commodities, yeah, there's no such mechanism. So we really need to deal with it on a situation by situation basis. And for sure, there's a lot of supply chain pressures right now that we need to deal with, both in terms of the costs of the parts or commodities themselves, but also the cost of shipping.
Do you think about higher interest rates? The Bank of Canada has signaled that rates will go unchanged for about 2 years, although economists and rate watchers have suggested otherwise. Does that concern you?
Well, of course, growing interest costs are going to put extra pressure on businesses overall. I mean, from our perspective, we have been extremely careful in terms of spending and in terms of cash conservation throughout the last 12 months. So happily, we have a lower level of exposure today than we did 12 months ago or even 2 years ago in terms of levels of debt. But that said, you know, that can obviously change if an acquisition comes along, if some other reason for increased spending comes. So, you know, higher interest rates are for sure make it tougher. But, you know, it's another piece of the puzzle that we need to manage. And what are our debt levels and what are we spending and how do we minimize those expenses?
Canada's Semiconductor Council recently formed to address the global chip shortage. Was this chip shortage the wake-up call that Canada needed to start developing and manufacturing in this space?
Yeah, I mean, I think that what's happened with the semiconductor chips over the last 6 months is really just such a strong level of demand. This is as a result of, first of all, the spike in demand for consumer electronics that is very much COVID related, and then exacerbated by the big surge back in the auto industry after, of course, the shutdown months last year, and the need at that time had dried up. For chips. So the automakers stopped buying them, cut orders, and capacity was reallocated. It's interesting, though, if you go back to 2010, we had a very, very similar situation where, again, out of the recession, there had been cutbacks to chips. And same thing, capacity got reallocated. And there was a huge struggle at the time as well. Around chip capacity. And same thing, it took time to get that chip capacity put back in place, but there's, you know, investments happening in a few different places, and that should really start to make a difference as we get into the back half of the year in particular, that we start to see a little more supply coming in. So Canada getting involved, other countries as well, I think that's really going to help the situation.
How did it specifically affect Linamar?
Well, it's affecting us because it's affecting our customers. So our customers are having to shut plants down for lack of chips. They're doing some, in some cases, they're doing sort of sub-assembly or even full vehicle assembly and leaving a way that they can come back in and insert the chips later in order to more quickly get product out and into the pipeline once those chips start flowing. But you know, regardless of that, we're still seeing vehicle plant and now powertrain plant shutdowns as well. So we ship to both the vehicle plants and the powertrain plants, probably a little more to the powertrain plants. So we're feeling the impact a little bit more now than we would have, let's say, 6 or 8 weeks ago when it was more of the vehicle plants who were being impacted. But it's interesting because it really is a situation that's playing out day to day. And depending on how quickly those chips start flowing again, I mean, we could even see recovery this quarter if things went well, but more likely to see recovery in those lost vehicle volumes in the back half of the year. But you know, the really good news is demand is exceptionally high. You know, if we look at the seasonally adjusted rate of selling of vehicles in North America in April, it was the second highest in history, like in history. So demand is exceptionally high. And March of this year was the third highest seasonally adjusted rate of selling in history. So demand is super high. Inventories are very, very low. So the good news is we will make this up. The demand is there. We need to get that pipeline filled up. So once the chips start flowing, we should see a sustained time period of strong production levels here in North America, which is good news.
You recently partnered with Ballard Power Systems to develop hydrogen fuel cells for light vehicles. Make the case here, Linda, for hydrogen fuel cells when the world is all about battery and Tesla.
Yeah, so we're big believers in the future of hydrogen as a great solution for mobility, for all types of mobility, whether it be commercial vehicles, heavy truck, which is probably the first place we're going to see it evolve, all the way through to passenger cars. And really, a battery electric vehicle and a fuel cell electric vehicle are not that different. They're both electric vehicles. They both drive off of an electric motor, an e-axle that's made up of basically an electric motor and a gearbox and a controller. So that's sort of the powertrain of the electric vehicle. And then in the battery electric, it runs off of a battery, obviously a big battery pack. And in a fuel cell electric vehicle, it runs off the fuel cell. So it's really just it's actually not as different as it may sound, and actually I think can transition quite smoothly from battery electric into fuel cell electric. So that's the first, I think, important thing to understand. Secondly, why are we big believers in hydrogen? I would say basically four things. Number one, and this is probably the most important, is it's truly zero emissions. Like from the source of that power, from the source of the fuel, all the way through to the tailpipe, we're looking at a zero emissions vehicle with a fuel cell. So a battery electric vehicle, that's not the case typically because you have to consider the carbon footprint of the source of the electricity, right? So we're lucky here in Canada, we have very high levels of renewable energy. Only I think around 20 or 25% of our grid is carbon-based power. But in a lot of other countries, the US, for instance, 60 or 62% carbon-based power. The China is also 60 or 62% carbon-based power. So there's a big, you know, CO2 emission footprint that's happening there. Whereas to make hydrogen, you can use renewable energy to turn water into hydrogen. And then, you know, that hydrogen is the fuel of the fuel cell and turns back into water as the byproduct of the fuel cell operation. So what I like about that is it's like you're running your car on solar or wind energy that's sort of temporarily stored in hydrogen. So I think that's probably the most important thing, in my opinion, is that it is a real, a truly green emission solution. Fuel cell vehicles can be quickly refueled just as fast as an internal combustion engine car, which is something that we're used to, right? So it's just what we're used to. Hydrogen has a very high density of energy, so it's a very efficient source of energy. And lastly, and I think this is pretty important as well, fuel cell electric vehicles don't rely on sort of regionally concentrated sources of important elements like lithium or cobalt for their operation. So cobalt in particular is one of concern, given a little more than 50% of the world's cobalt reserves are found in the Congo. And a third of those are what they call artisanally mined, which means mined by hand. And I think that's not a great sustainability model. And then 80% of that cobalt is refined in China. So, you know, a pretty strong control over the cobalt market and therefore battery electric market out of just one country. So that regional concentration, I think, is something we need to think about when we're making these sustainability decisions.
As you see it, what is the trajectory of this partnership? Ballard has some of the components. Linamar has some of the components, the chassis, the axle. Are you going to develop a cookie cutter mold for other auto manufacturers?
Yeah, I mean, I really love the idea of this partnership because I feel like we've got Ballard with, you know, such strength and history and technology development around the whole fuel cell system. You couple that with our expertise in the e-axle, right? That propulsion system for the electric vehicle, which is a key product for us at Linamar, as well as you pointed out, the whole chassis system, the rolling chassis. We also have a hydrogen tank that we have developed for fuel cell electric vehicles. So we've got complementary pieces of the puzzle, you know, and we can literally create what we envision as this sort of rolling chassis that comes into the automaker and they mount the rest of the vehicle right on top of it. So we really like that idea. We also think, as I was describing earlier, we can have a bit of a plug and play kind of technology approach whereby you can reasonably easily transform a battery electric vehicle into a fuel cell electric vehicle simply by taking out that battery pack and replacing it with our fuel cell powertrain that we're packaging up with Ballard. So I quite like that idea because it, again, allows that transition to happen more easily.